Welcome to the video series by Altium on high-speed design. My name is Lee Ritchey with Speeding Edge. What we're going to do today is answer a question that is often asked by new designers. What are the common SI issues in high-speed designs? SI meaning signal integrity. And I'll endeavor to show you what they are in this video. So first of all, we're going to talk about what signal integrity is, because if we don't know what that is, we're kind of not starting off right. It is delivering logic signals to receivers that have enough quality so the circuit works all the time. That's in a nutshell, signal integrity. There's five main areas in signal integrity to worry about. I have them here more or less in the order which we saw them appear on the horizon. First, we worried about managing reflections. Right after that, crosstalk became an issue. Not too long after that, power delivery became an issue because the so-called rules of thumb for designing power delivery did not work. And then we started to worry about making sure the signals arrive at the same time, and that basically we're talking about is primarily buses, like in a DDR memory. And then, of course, managing EMI. EMI crept in fairly early in this set of points here, but I'm going to cover it last because it just happens to be on my list that way. So let's talk about reflections first. Where these happen is when we have changed impedance along a transmission line and our signal traveling down there, gets reflected back or maybe off the end of the transmission line. And we will do things, we'll control the reflections off the end of the line with terminations. And we're going to minimize reflections along the length of the line, make sure that the impedance does not change as we go from one end to the other. And careful stack-up design is required to do that, and care with where we put the loads. And reflections off the end of the line are going to be controlled by one of two techniques. They're both terminators. One would be termination at the driver output, the other at the called series termination, the other at the receiver end called parallel. In CMOS, virtually everything is series terminated because parallel termination turns out to consume way too much power. There is very little of that left. In fact, the only place I see parallel terminations now is the data lines of DDR and the ends of all the differential pairs. Stack up is where impedance is determined, and so we are going to have to use something to determine what structures are going to yield the impedance we're looking for. That's a 2D field solver. And a part of that is we have to have accurate information on the laminate, because what the dielectric constant is of the laminate has a direct effect on impedance. So those are the things we'll do for that topic. Crosstalk. This is when one line switches next to another that's running parallel, energy will be induced in what we call the victim line. And we want to make sure that we've chosen structure such that whatever is coupled into the victim is within the limits of that logic family to live with. There's two ways in a printed circuit board we can have this problem. If we route side by side in the same layer, that is often called inductive crosstalk, or if we route by mistake one over the top of the other in adjacent layers, that usually is called capacitive crosstalk. In the case of adjacent layers, will make one X and the other Y, so that problem does not happen. Now, how much crosstalk is okay is a difficult question to answer. It depends on a number of things. One of them is how much noise can a victim tolerate, and it varies by logic family. So coming up with a set of rules that works requires you to have a 2 or 3D field solver that lets you calculate for a proposed routing structure what you'll get, and you compare what you get from that to what is allowed, and almost always you'll discover where you thought was okay will not be, and we'll iterate on that until we come up with a structure that is acceptable. Now, once the spacing rules are figured out, it's in the hands of the board layout designer to obey those. One of the things that is difficult to do is to manage that with your eye. And in complex boards, that's pretty hard to do. So we will load this information into route control files. I know the Altium tool has that, so that whether you hand route or auto route, you don't violate those rules. Next up is robust PDS system. For years and years and years, it didn't matter very much what you did, and we had what I would consider arbitrary bypass capacitor rules. PDS again stands for power delivery system. And if your system isn't designed well, the number one symptom is you have a lot of ripple on VDD. And one of our goals is to make sure that ripple is small enough that our logic circuits are happy. It turns out the most common source of EMI is that very same ripple. In fact, I've been troubleshooting EMI problems for probably 30 years. And everyone I can remember, I could trace to the poorly designed power delivery system. I can't think of one that was not. And the reason for that is people follow app notes that have not been upgraded for probably 30 years. The classic 0.1, 0.01 microfarad capacitor will guarantee you a bad PDS. And of course, if that ripple gets onto a logic signal that's big enough, it'll cause logic failures. And the way we take care of that is with a good PDS design. And there exist tools to do that, quite a few of them out there right now. I believe that Altium has one as part of the suite of tools here. For years and years and years, the number one reason that products were late to market, they would not pass EMI tests. Everything else worked fine, but not EMI. And of course, those who didn't understand what EMI was considered it to be black magic or mysterious and not following the laws of physics. That, of course, isn't true, and nothing magic about EMI. If you have an EMI problem, you by accident made a radio transmitter. That's exactly what happened. And you have energy inside your product that is in the EMI band that found its way out somehow. And most every time I've seen this, the out finding its way out is on one of the wires that go in and out of the box. Those then look like really good antennas. So again, excess ripple on the PDS is a dominant one. Again, I have a hard time remembering a time when I found an EMI problem that wasn't PDS ripple. And so you wouldn't be surprised in the seminars I teach that the number one step on my EMI presentation is design a good PDS. And that happens to be how I fix PDS problems. EMI problems, I redesign the PDS for my clients. There's no good tools in case of EMI to predict EMI will happen. There are some who attempt to do that, but I have not seen any of that work. So summing up this section, what we're doing with signal integrity is ensuring that all the signals in the design are good enough as they arrive at the receiver so the product always works reliably. There are lots of good tools to help you do that. Unlike when I started out, there were no tools. Now all the tools are in place. They all work very well. Now, SI engineering is not a one-person job. It requires three groups to work together. Of course, the design engineer is part of that, the SI expert's part of that, and the board designer. Those three have to work together to make sure all those goals are met. I probably ought to add that we have to put in here, because stack up is a big issue, you need to include the engineer at the fab shop. So that's what signal integrity is all about. I hope this video was of some use to you. If it was, pass it on to your colleagues. If you have any suggestions of other topics we ought to cover, let us know. We'll see if we can't put together a video. Again, this is Lee Ritchey, Speeding Edge. Thanks for watching.